Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Mean Gene Show here, streaming live on podbean.com. Hope you had a great weekend. It is Monday, March 21st, 2022. And guess what, folks? We are going to have a great show. Here's what we're talking about, the Sweet 16. What is your bracket looking like? I tell you what, now, my bracket is looking somewhat decent, And when I say that, it's because I believe three of my Final Four teams still exist, although it was one crazy weekend in the NCAA tournament, as I am going to refresh my bracket here just to make sure I'm not giving you bogus information. I believe I still have at least, I have three of my Final Four teams still in this tournament. But anyway, hey, hope your bracket is still intact. Hope you are having, I hope you had a great weekend. So like I said, we got a lot of stuff to talk about here today on the Mean Gene Show, with including the Sweet 16. We're going to talk about some of the games that took place Saturday and Sunday, some great ones. Something about those number four seeds and those number nine seeds, man, they are really, well, at least this weekend, they were pretty entertaining. Big upsets in the NCAA tournament, of course. Now, if you're like me, you know, you're looking at your bracket and you're saying, man, I don't want the upset, but, you know, because it's going to screw up my bracket. But at the same time, you're like, man, I really do want to see this team win, you know. And that's, I get caught up in that every year, because at some point in time, you know, when you see a thriller, a good game, you don't care. You just, like, the hell with it. Tear up your bracket. Your bracket is going to be ruined anyway. And that's how I kind of felt this weekend with some of these games. So we're also going to talk about NFL free agency updates, Deshaun Watson, the big mega deal, and the Browns, and where do the Browns go with Baker Mayfield, or where do Baker Mayfield go? That's going to be pretty interesting. So we'll talk about that towards the end of the show. And of course, I got to talk about the NBA, right? Got to talk about some of the action that happened on Friday night, because we got 3 days worth of action to talk about in the NBA. Even with all of the madness, the March madness that took place, we still have to talk about the NBA, and we're going to do that. We're going to talk about the games on Friday, games on Saturday and Sunday, Warriors, 76ers, the Celtics and the Raptors. I mean, all of those teams were, we really keyed in on those teams last week, and we'll let you know how they done or how they did over the weekend. So anyway, all right. So hey, just sit back and relax. It's Monday, okay? Now, it's going to be interesting this week, because as you know, we're going to New York, and I'll talk about that a little bit later in the show. So this is, I have to slow down, because I know I haven't packed for a trip that I know that I knew about a long time ago. I still need to pack. As soon as this show is over with, I have a ton of things I need to do. And number one is pack for New York and get ready. Got to take equipment up there and everything. It's just things that you probably don't want to hear about. So, all right. Well, let's start with the NCAA tournament over the weekend. And man, there was some great games. So I had to get out and do yard work. I got started early on Saturday because I knew I needed to be sitting in front of the TV and watching some great college basketball. And hey, it started with the Baylor. Baylor was the first number one seed to go down in this tournament. And I tell you what, oh my goodness, what a game though. All right, they went down. And North Carolina, that score was, it was an overtime. Now this was an interesting game, because North Carolina, was up by some 25 points in this game, and the Baylor Bears, the defending champions, they played like defending champions. They played exactly the way you're supposed to play when you're on the ropes. You know, you won the title last year. You're there. You're still there until someone knocks you down. And that's just the way it is. And the Baylor Bears came back roaring to force overtime. And although they came up short in that game, Hubert Davis and the North Carolina Tar Heels defeated the Baylor Bears 93-86 in overtime, and it was a hell of a game. And I really thought Baylor was going to come back. You know, it's just one of those games where you ever seen those games where, you know, a team is just seemed like they planned to keep from losing instead of winning. That's what I felt about North Carolina on Saturday. But they got the win. And Hubert Davis, oh my goodness, what is going on with North Carolina? I mean, they have just been on a roll ever since they defeated Duke for Coach K's farewell last regular season game at Cameron Indoor Stadium. And they have been rolling. And Hubert Davis has received a lot of criticism this year. The North Carolina Tar Heels wasn't, you know, highly ranked there, you know, this year. I mean, there were high expectations, but when they didn't meet them, people just sort of gave up on them. And man, woo-wee, I tell you, the Tar Heels, and they are an eighth seed, highly respectable eighth seed now. No one's really paying attention to the seeds now. When you get this deep into the NCAA tournament, they just watch. It's all about watching the film. The hell with the numbers. The hell with the seeds. Now, if you make the Sweet 16, believe me, you're good. You just like being number one, and that's what's going on. So, how about that? The North Carolina Tar Heels in the Sweet 16s, and they have been there. As a matter of fact, I've seen them a few years ago in the Final Four in Houston. This was a few years ago. I think was it 2016, 2018? But anyway, the Tar Heels are back, and they are no strangers to NCAA championships as well. So how about, and if that wasn't a thriller, then it was the number one seed Kansas. Boy, they survived a scare from that number nine seed Creighton, and they know they did. They know it's like, okay, you heard the term, hey, man, y'all stole one. And they did. Kansas, I really thought Creighton was going to knock off Kansas in that game. And for some reason, Bill Self, when you got a team, when you got a coach like that, and, oh, man, it was just a hell of a game. Now, I want to give some stats on that game because I sat there and I watched that, and I have a friend of mine, Fred Farley, his grandson played in this game, and he actually had a pretty good game, actually kept Kansas in that game. That's Jalen Wilson. Played 32 minutes, 14 points, 14 rebounds. Those 14 points was critical. They came at some very meaningful times there as Kansas gets that win and advance to the Sweet 16. The next game we have over the weekend was the number 11 seed Michigan Wolverines versus the number 3 seed Tennessee. Tennessee Volunteers. Yep, Tennessee. So Tennessee, the number 3 seed, and we had spoke very highly of Tennessee, especially after they, you know, went through the SEC tournament, won that tournament, came out, played well, got into the NCAA tournament, and you know, didn't disappoint until they faced this Michigan team, which is scary. Now, when me and Dustin Pfeiffer did our NCAA tournament bracket show last week, early last week, we mentioned how Michigan survived what we call, you know, just that bad publicity after the Juwan Howard situation. And we knew that when Michigan got into this tournament, and I go on the record and say again that I didn't think Michigan was going to even make the NCAA tournament. I had talked about that. I had wrote about that, and, you know, they get the second chance, you know, to redeem themselves, and look at what they're doing now, the Michigan Wolverines. And one thing about Michigan and basketball, you know, it kind of goes hand in hand. He's got – Juwan Howard is a good coach. Michigan is right there where they expected to be and right there where they should be because they have been there for the last few years. This is how Juwan Howard you know, he gets the job at his alma mater, but at the same time, he got one hell of a pay raise for getting Michigan to the Elite Eight. And look, so if you haven't watched a lot of Michigan basketball, well, that would be the West Coast probably because the East Coast, everyone knows all about Michigan. Michigan is looking really, really good. And I tell you what, I text Dustin over the weekend and I said, this team is very scary. The Michigan Wolverines is a very scary team. And there's no telling how far they're going to go in this tournament. Like I said, right now, we are at the Sweet 16. And right now, any of the 16 teams that are in this thing could win the national championship. If you watch how they have played over the last couple of days, any of them could win. I don't care, regardless of the seed. And that includes St. Peter's. We got to talk about them too. But anyway, because you play great basketball, no one's going to look at what seed you are at this point, okay? And I keep saying that because it's so true. Okay, now the number four seed, Providence Friars. Man, they're looking really good. Now, this is probably the scariest of the scariest team because Providence is just beating people. They are just not making it close. They're not going to get you. You're not going to get in an overtime situation with Providence. You're just not going to. They are definitely, and I've talked about this Providence team too. Man, it's just great, great basketball. They routed Richmond, and they get to their first Sweet 16 in 25 years. Man, when you got that kind of monkey on your back, you are certainly trying to let people know you mean business. And they do. They are really looking good. And they are a four seed and deservingly so. And you can see why. They win 79-51. I think that was probably the biggest rout of the weekend, if I'm not mistaken. But anyway, how about that? The Providence Friars in the Sweet 16 for the first time in 25 years. Another game, the number four seed, UCLA Bruins, they're also looking pretty good. You know, UCLA, no strangers to the NCAA tournament and winning championships. They made quick work of St. Mary's, the Gales. Now, this was a 4-5 seed. The 4 seeds are looking pretty good in this tournament. And so are those 9 seeds, well, some of them anyway. But UCLA, they made quick work. Now, this was a struggle first in the first half of this game, but they put it away in the second half. Took care of business, won the game 72-56. And, you know, it's UCLA basketball. You know, if anybody's going to be respected in these NCAA tournaments, it's going to be UCLA Bruins. They know a little something about winning championships. So not surprised at all to see the Bruins back where they belong, which is, you know, running deep into this NCAA tournament. So they are in the Sweet 16. Okay, so let's talk about the team everybody is having fun with. And these kids are having fun. But you know how they carry themselves? These peacocks, they are the St. Peter's Peacocks, and they would not go away. I see you, Jersey boys, getting it done over the number 7 seed, Murray State. And it was a 70-60 win there for the 15th seed over the 7th seed. You know, and this team is undersized. If you watch that game against Murray State, they just how could they win? You know, how were they winning? How are they able to do this? But they got it done. They got it done. This is crazy now. And we said it. There's always a 12 or 11 seed team. Not that many 12 seed teams in the Sweet 16. I don't know if there's any, but there's a 15 seed. And I believe there's 2 11 seeds that are in the Final Four. That's not uncommon. But man, you got a 15 seed here. And woo-wee. And I know for a fact that they are, no one is going to, you know, people are going to really be paying attention to this team. And trying to figure out who they're going to be playing here. We'll look at that here a little bit later in the matchups here coming up for the Sweet 16 this Thursday and Friday. So, all right, what do we got here? The next game, we have the number 4 seed Arkansas Razorbacks barely got past New Mexico State. And this was one of the ugliest games of the day. And I mean, it was ugly. At one particular time, I didn't think that either team was going to have 10 points by the halftime. It was ugly. So now I'm going to tell you how ugly it was because the numbers don't lie, right? Arkansas won this game shooting 27% from the field, 18% from the three-point line. Now, but they did have 12 steals and 15 fast break points off those stills. But man, it was a tough game to watch, and you know, and it wasn't like the other day when you could have switched the channel and go to another game because there was multiple games being played at the same time. So you actually had to sit and watch this game. At least I did, because I'm a fan of Arkansas. But man, it was tough to watch. I'm not gonna lie, it was tough to watch. I'm glad they got the win, but oh my goodness, it was interesting. It was an interesting game to watch. So anyway, Arkansas advanced. Now Arkansas, actually, you know, with a number four seed, sometimes teams will look at games like this, and you play a poor game, just like, you know, like Arizona, some of these other teams I'm gonna talk about here in a little bit. You play a poor game. You look at this film, man, you got to get better. And I would honestly say Arkansas has not played a decent game yet in this tournament, but they find a way to win. You know, somehow they managed to get 53 points in this game to win. I didn't think anybody was going to get anywhere near 53 points. They win 53-48, but it was just, you know, one of those type of games there. Tough game to watch. Now, these are our games from Saturday, by the way. So, number one, Gonzaga, the number one overall seed in this tournament. They squeaked by number nine, Memphis. That's Penny Hardaway's team. And they win that game 82-78. And it's just something about those number nine seeds. I told you in the tournament this year, something about that. Memphis should have won that game. Okay, I really thought Gonzaga was going down. I really did. And remember, this game was played in Portland, Oregon, which is not very far from where the Gonzaga Bulldogs play in the state of Washington. But man, they got it done, and that's what good teams do. They find a way to win. And I, you know, Penny Hardaway, he had to be proud of his team for nearly, you know, pulling off an upset, and there was a reason why they were number nine, a number nine seed. Some people thought maybe they should have been a little bit higher than that, but man, they nearly put off a big upset on Saturday over Gonzaga. But Gonzaga's still there, folks. They are still there. Arizona's still there. Kansas is still there. So there's only one number one seed that's not in this tournament, and that is the Baylor Bears. Okay, on Sunday. Let's go ahead and talk about the action that took place on Sunday in the NCAA tournament. It was the number five seed, Houston Cougars. They won over the number four seed, Fighting Illini. Okay, now, now that I look at it, I'm thinking Illinois may have been overranked in this tournament. I don't know. I just haven't. They just, you know, Houston just really just played them, just outplayed them. You could say maybe outcoached them. You know, Kevin Sampson is no stranger to this tournament. You guys remember Kevin Sampson when he coached Oklahoma? This is a good coach, and they get the win 68-53, and that is an upset. You're talking about a number five seed. Now I know 5-4 is not that much different when you look at it from a competitive standpoint on paper, but this was an upset, and that's why I said Illinois. I kind of thought they were overranked there in this tournament by getting that fourth seed. Houston probably should have got that. They are used to winning games convincingly. If they're going to win, they're going to win convincingly, or lose, you know, convincingly. But they, man, they got it done. So now, so the interesting thing about this game, after the game, Kevin Sampson does his post-game interview. Okay. And then they somehow show some footage from the locker room where a shirtless Kelvin Sampson is in there jumping around, and the team is throwing water over him. It was just funny to see. And I tell you what, though, and you've probably heard some of the analysts on TV say the emotion of winning these games. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. As a coach myself, now I coach women's and men's basketball, but mainly women's, and winning a championship, or winning at any level as a coach, as a player, is exciting. And I know I've won, you know, some championships, some big games. And of course, now I've never, you know, tucked my shirt off in the locker room or whatever. But you got to understand. You got to understand why the excitement. And with the kids just love it because they see you, you know, out of character, so to speak. But they see you as being real and having fun. And some of the ways you see how these coaches connect to their players. And this is why this is so exciting to see. But man, what a big win for the Houston Cougars. And like I said, any of these 16 teams that, and that's why the Sweet 16 this weekend is going to be so much fun to watch. Any one of these teams, from what I've seen and how they played, you know, especially over this weekend, is capable of winning the NCAA championship. So, and that includes you folks in Jersey City, the St. Peter's Peacocks. So I count you guys in too, playing some great basketball. You deserve to be where you are. Okay, the next game we have there is the number 2 seed Villanova Wildcats. You guys remember Jay Wright won 2 NCAA titles. I think he won 2016 and 2018. So no one is really talking a lot about, you know, Villanova. That's the number 2 seed there. And, man, you know, they can get this thing done again. They beat Ohio State 71-61, just overmatched and over, probably coached. That's what we said. You know, when you're looking at a guy that's been in this thing for a while, Villanova is no stranger to the NCAA tournament or hanging up those banners. So watch the Wildcats as they continue to move about this NCAA tournament. Okay, so the next one, how about the classic matchup? And everyone was sort of, you know, anticipating it and waiting on it. Michigan State and Duke. You got the number 7 seed Michigan State versus the number 2 seed Duke. Everyone knows Coach K is retiring this year. This is his farewell, so to speak. And his team, I tell you, I got Duke going to the Final Four. There's no way they're going to get this far and not take and get Coach K, try to send him off the right way. They didn't do it for his last home game at Cameron. And believe me, those kids are going to go out there and play their hearts out and try to get Coach K into this NCAA championship game on April 4th in New Orleans. But anyway, my late co-host, Outrod Johnson, love him some Tom Izzo. And I like Tom Izzo too. But man, Duke was just a little bit too much for Tom Izzo and the Michigan State Spartans on Sunday. So they win 85-76 to advance to the Sweet 16. Duke is no stranger to the Sweet 16 or the Final Four or to winning NCAA championships. Okay, the number 11 seed, Iowa State, they defeated, and this is the Cyclones, the Iowa State Cyclones. Remember the Hawkeyes, they were the number 5 seed. They got an early exit out of this tournament. And I think I said on one of the shows last week that maybe we were looking at the wrong Iowa team or the wrong team in the state of Iowa. We should have been looking at Iowa State. Number 11 seed. That's one of those 11th seed teams that advanced to the Sweet 16. They defeated Wisconsin, the number 3 seed, the Badgers. Not sure what happened with Wisconsin. They only put up 49 points in this game. Not sure what happened. Iowa State wins 54-49 in a game that, you know, this one wasn't easy to watch. Wasn't as bad as the Arkansas game because they, you know, the team shot a little bit better than that Arkansas game. I'm trying to pull up my stats here just to see. Well, no, yeah, Wisconsin didn't shoot too much better than those Razorbacks. They shot 29% from the field, and the Cyclones shot 34% from the field. So it wasn't really that, you know, it wasn't the greatest game to watch, and that was probably one of the second worst games to watch. But anyway, you had a number 11 seed knocking off a number 3 seed, and Wisconsin is gone. I think they were shocked. Their fans were shocked. And I was shocked because I haven't watched any Iowa State basketball games this year. Probably more Iowa games than Iowa State. And like I said, the expectations were high on the Hawkeyes, not the Cyclones. But anyway, the Cyclones are in the Sweet 16. The number 10 seed, Miami Hurricanes. Now, they should have won against the number 2 seed, Auburn. They really should have won. If anybody watched that game, and they really, wait a minute. You know what? They did. Okay, so they did win. All right. I must be talking about another game here. I am so sorry. You know what? So, yes, it was the number 10 seed. The number 10 seed, Miami, Florida Hurricanes. And I thought they won that game. They won 79-61. I don't know what happened to Bruce Pearl's team, just like I don't know what happened to my notes. But Bruce Pearl, Auburn, at one particular time, was the number one team in the country. Played in the SEC, really, really good team. So I think this was the biggest upset, really, of the weekend. Because Miami, for number 10 seed, I didn't even think Miami, the Miami Hurricanes played good enough to even make the tournament. But, you know, they come in as a number 10 seed and they get it done. But how about that? 79-61 was not even close. I don't know what happened to Bruce Pearl's team, the Auburn Tigers. I don't know what happened, but man, they are in there. So yeah, we had a 10 seed that snuck in there. So sorry about that. Oh my goodness. But anyway, this and this was one of those games I was telling you about too, where you said, God dang it, if Auburn wins, it's going to screw up my bracket. But there you are sitting there rooting for Miami to beat them. And that's exactly what happened in this game. And I did watch at least the second half of this game, because I tried to at least, you know, put my eyes on as many of these games as I could. And this was one that I definitely did catch at the second half, probably the last 10 minutes of this game I watched. But anyway, the number 10 seed, Miami Hurricanes, defeated, not really used to talking about Miami Hurricanes and college basketball, right? More football. It's a more, you know, football school than basketball. Okay, the next one we have, the Texas Longhorns is the number 6 seed, and Purdue Boilermakers number 3 seed. So Purdue, another team that do not take your eyes off them. They defeated Texas 81-71 to advance to the Sweet 16. And I have them in one of my brackets, probably in the Elite 8. So we'll see how things match up this weekend. And I think the last game that was played last night, and this is the one where I had my notes screwed up here. TCU should have won. TCU, the number 9 seed, was winning the regulation of this game against the number 1 seed, Arizona Wildcats. I don't know what happened. It seemed like there was some questionable, maybe a no call there. The game almost was won on a slam dunk. But the time, it seemed like the ball was still in the kid's hand there right before the buzzer. Well, it was in his hand at the buzzer. So the referee waved off the basket, forced the overtime. But TCU should have won the game in regulation. The number 1 seed, Arizona Wildcats, won 85-80 in overtime. So this is where I had my notes mixed up with the Miami game. But now we're back on track. So they get it done. And this is one of those games where I guarantee you, whoever plays Arizona next is going to suffer. Because you watch a game like that, and you know how close it was. You know how close you came to actually losing this game. You came very close to nearly, you know, getting beat and eliminated out the tournament as a number 1 seed. I really thought they were going down. I thought Gonzaga was going down. When Memphis had the lead on them, I said, oh my goodness, this is going to be the weekend. Kansas, we might lose all 4 number 1 seeds, but that wasn't the case. So anyway, the Arizona Wildcats survive, and believe me, they are a good team. But TCU, man, they that close. What's the commercial? Was it State Farm commercial? Ooh, you almost had it. You was almost there. Well, anyway, that's how I felt about TCU. So let's set up the Sweet 16 real quick. I'm going to go over the games that will be played on Thursday, and this is March 24th. So now you have your number 4 seed versus the number one. That's the Arkansas Razorbacks versus the Gonzaga Bulldogs. That game is going to be played on Thursday, and we'll be talking about that. As a matter of fact, me and Dustin Pfeiffer, Dustin works for Bally Sports Southeast, covers the Carolina Panthers and the Charlotte Hornets. We are doing a show Wednesday, just even, you know, the Sweet 16 show. We always do it every year, and we are going to break this down a whole lot more. So if I don't talk about it on tomorrow's show, you'll know why. But Wednesday, there's going to be a separate show, and that's going to be an iHeartRadio show, by the way. So we'll break down the Sweet 16. But you got number four seed Arkansas versus number one seed Gonzaga on Thursday. Then you have a matchup that is, oh, made in heaven. The number 11 seed Michigan Wolverines versus the number two seed Villanova. I believe it's Wildcats. I've been screwing up these mascot names lately. But, man, Michigan and Villanova. Are you kidding me? So I don't know where I'm going to be Thursday. I know I'm going to be flying back from New York, but I got to quickly get in front of a TV because there are some good matchups, and it gets better. How about this? The number three seed, Texas Tech, the Red Raiders will take on the Duke Blue Devils, the number three versus number two. So are you listening to me? We got Arkansas versus Gonzaga, Michigan versus Villanova, Texas Tech versus Duke. This is all Thursday in the Sweet 16, and it gets better than the nightcap. It all ends Thursday night with the number five seed Houston Cougars versus the number one seed Arizona. I believe they're Wildcats. Okay, I'm getting my Wildcats and Devils mixed up here. But, man, you get, Thursday is going to be great for college basketball. I don't know if the NBA, I'm sure the NBA's got something going on Thursday, but this is must-see TV for the Sweet 16. And then on Friday, it gets even better, folks. This is your lineup for Friday's NCAA March Madness Sweet 16. Are you ready? You got the St. Peter's Peacocks from Jersey City, New Jersey, number 15 seed versus number three Purdue Boilermakers. Watch out, Purdue. Purdue, I don't know what you guys did after you win the other day, but you probably should be watching some film. Hell, you might even should take a trip to Jersey and learn as much as you can about these Peacocks, because this could be an upset. This could really, really go down. It's a big time upset. And it's the first game that's going to kick off on Friday, followed by another great matchup. The Providence Friars, the number four seed, will take on the number one seed Kansas Jayhawks. It's going to be a great one. I'm telling you. Now, Purdue is a 12.5 favorite to win. I don't know. I ain't buying that. I would take St. Peter's all day and every day. Okay, on that particular game. Now, I probably should consult with Jeff Lambert Sr., Mr. Picks, you know, my sports betting expert there, but I don't like that. I just don't like that. Anyway, so you got St. Peter's versus Purdue on Friday, followed by Providence versus Kansas. Okay, then, oh my goodness, another classic matchup. The number eight seed North Carolina Tar Heels versus the number four seed UCLA Bruins. You tell me this ain't a classic matchup. I wonder what the tickets prices are for some of these Sweet 16 matchups. And I can tell you, because I looked at the San Antonio bracket there for the Sweet 16, and they had $300 tickets. I have never seen $300 tickets for the Sweet 16. As a matter of fact, the tickets for the Sweet 16 in that San Antonio region, they cost more than Final Four tickets to the Final Four in New Orleans. Go figure. I don't know. Anyway, and those tickets probably have gone up since then, but there are some hella matchups here in the Sweet 16 this weekend. And then, not this weekend, but this Thursday and Friday. And then the last game on Friday will be in this good matchup here. How about this? Two double-seeded teams here. You got the Iowa State Cyclones, the number 11 seed Iowa State Cyclones versus the number 10 seed Miami Hurricanes. So that's going to be the night capper, the last game on Friday. So there's your Sweet 16. And And like I said, me and Dustin Pfeiffer, we're going to do a show this Wednesday, specifically on the Sweet 16. So we're going to go more in depth on all of these matchups here, because these are going to be some classic games played on Thursday and Friday. Some matchups I just haven't seen in years. It used to be classic matchups. You got some good schools, good coaches going against each other. So that's going to be good to see. All right. So we should probably jump into the NBA, right? I think, a lot of stuff happened over the weekend here. And I know for a fact, I want to go all the way back to Friday and talk about some of these games that happened here. And one of them was the Brooklyn Nets, a team that I have really been talking about a lot, because I'm worried about whether or not they're going to make some headways and get out of that eighth spot in the NBA standings. And I'm going to go over those standings here in a little bit. But on Friday night, though, they did have a big-time win over the Portland Trailblazers. Everybody's just beating Portland, right? So that should be nothing new. Anyway, so on Friday night, it was the Nets winning 128-123. Kevin Durant, 38 points, 6 assists, 6 rebounds. You know, a lot. Kevin Durant has been in the news a lot. So if he's not criticizing the mayor of New York, he's cursing out fans and giving, whatever he's doing. He's going back and forth. So Kevin Durant, very sensitive right now. He didn't always used to be like that, because I met him when he was with the Oklahoma City Thunder. Had a chance to interview him in the locker room. And that was early in his career, and he was a very nice guy. But things have changed with Kevin Durant over the years. And now he, remember the burner accounts he had on Twitter and on social media, because he couldn't go in as Kevin Durant, but he definitely wanted to, because he couldn't take all of the feedback that was coming out there. He wanted to have a way to respond to his critics. So he set up these burner accounts. Anyway, it was funny. And they discovered it was him. And he still goes at the fans. I think the NBA fined him for cursing at a fan or something like that the other day. And we're talking about fans in his own city of New York, right? I mean, Brooklyn. So I don't know what's going on. But anyway, they get a win. And let's see, where did that win put them in the standings? They're still in that eighth spot. Now, I don't know what it's going to take to get them out of that eighth spot in the Eastern Conference. But, stay tuned. They're probably going to find a way to get out of there. But anyway, they get the win. So also on Friday, it was the Hawks and the Grizzlies. Now, this was supposed to be a good matchup, because we always like to see Trae Young versus Ja Morant, right? And that wasn't the case on Friday, as the Hawks defeated the Memphis Grizzlies. Now, and they defeated the Memphis Grizzlies without Trae Young. Trae Young did not play in this game, although Ja Morant had 29 points in this game. But Trae Young was out of this game with that left quad injury. So that was pretty shocking that the Hawks could get it done. But Bogdanović had 30 points. And when that guy gets to shooting, he's just a good shooter. So 30 points there. They get it done. They knock off Memphis. And Memphis is still holding on steady, I believe, in that for the second seed over in the Western Conference. I don't believe that win hurt them at all. It did in a sense, because there's not that many games that separate Golden State and Memphis now, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But I thought that was interesting. Now, I will see the Hawks tomorrow night as they take on the New York Knicks from the Madison Square Garden. Looking forward to that. Should be an interesting game there to watch. Let's see. Neither one of those teams may not make the playoffs this year. So let's see there. Now, how about this breaking news from Friday? And that was the Lakers. The Lakers winning a road game. The Los Angeles Lakers actually won a road game in Toronto. Now, and this is important, because the Lakers had, prior to this game in Toronto, they had an 11-game losing streak, road game losing streak there. So they snapped that. They beat Toronto 128-123. LeBron James had 19 of his 36 points in that fourth quarter, but they got the win, and they actually slowed Toronto down because Toronto was on a hell of a win streak there prior to that game on Friday night. But anyway, so that's what happened there. Then on Saturday night, we're going to Saturday because we stick with the Lakers, because on Saturday the Lakers ended up playing the Washington Wizards. Now they lose the game 127-119, but LeBron James did surpass Karl Malone for number two on the NBA all-time scoring list. So, and that's about the way I thought it would happen if LeBron was going to pass Karl Malone. Believe me, it's not going to be. And this was on a back-to-back. The previous night they had beat Toronto, and then they had to go and play the Wizards, and they lose, and the Lakers are now 30-41. They are in the 10th spot. They just keep going down and down and down. Now, 10th spot, yeah, they actually are in a play-in position. And it can get worse for them, believe me. But right now, people still think they are probably the best 10th seed team right now, or 10th spot team in the NBA standings, right? So go figure, right? But anyway, thought that was quite interesting. And some other notable games that took place on Saturday. How about the Timberwolves? 138-119 win over the Bucks. And I told you about these Timberwolves. They are no joke. They are. Karl Anthony Towns had a double-double, 25 points, 11 rebounds in that game. But, man, big-time game. Now, the game was played there in Minneapolis, but it was a big-time win over the defending champions, by the way, Milwaukee Bucks. So I'm trying to see here. There is no way that Giannis played in this game, and he was out of that game. So that's probably one reason, but it looked like a dominant performance. I didn't see this game because I was all wrapped up in college basketball. But to me, it seemed like it was a dominant game regardless there. And the Timberwolves deserved that win. They got the win. The Dallas Mavericks, they lose to the Charlotte Hornets. Dallas, I think they finally end that long East Coast road trip, but they lose to the Charlotte Hornets 129-108. That game was also on Saturday, and that was about it. And then we get into some of the games from last night. So now, when I looked at this box score, I thought, well, wait a minute, this is not right. Because the Portland Trail Blazers lose another game by a similar score. The Indiana Pacers beat the Trail Blazers last night 129-98. But it was just about a few days ago, maybe sometime last week, that the Trail Blazers lost to someone by almost the same damn score. So I don't know what it is with Portland. I don't know what's going on with the Trailblazers. You know, they had that big trade. Oh, okay, it was the Knicks. Back on March 16th, they lose to the Knicks 128-98. And how about that? So 128-98 to the Knicks on March 16th. And then last night, they lose to the Pacers 129-98. So I, like I said, I don't really know what's going on. And then in both games, Josh Hart was the leading scorer for Portland, the losing team. So I just think that trade has just really screwed things up with the Portland Trail Blazers. Memphis Grizzlies, they win over the Houston Rockets. They, you know, redeem themselves and get after that loss to the Hawks. So they get the win 122-98 over the Rockets. And that was pretty much it. Now, I guess the Phoenix Suns, they needed overtime to beat the Sacramento Kings 127-124. And Devin Booker, 31.7 rebounds. And then the game I did kind of watch last night while I was watching the tournament, the Jazz over the Knicks 108-93. And the Boston Celtics continue to dominate. It doesn't matter where Boston play, at home, away, they beat the Nuggets 124-104 last night. And I think the Joker might be suspended. I think I just got a pop-up there message that the Joker is suspended. He might be suspended for let's see what he did. He did something that he shouldn't have done there. And man, you know, he got ejected out of a game a couple of months ago. So I don't know what the Joker got, some anger management going on with him. But anyway, so that is the NBA action. And then, of course, tonight, the NBA has a full schedule of games. And I will get you those. Let's see. And not every matchup is going to be worth watching. But I think you might be interested in the Heat versus the 76ers. You might want to see the Nets versus the Jazz. I would watch the Raptors versus the Bulls. And I think the Timberwolves and the Mavericks. The Mavericks will be back home in Dallas. I know they are relieved. So I think you might want to watch that one as well. So that should be a good one. Okay. So, all right. NFL free agency. Before we go here, people still talking about that Cleveland Browns. Deshaun Watson, folks are really talking about the Cleveland Browns and whether or not they did their homework before they brought in Deshaun Watson. And of course, I have my opinion on that. I think, you know, it's Cleveland Browns. If they feel that they could win with Deshaun Watson, and if they did their due diligence according to the attorney who is representing the women who have the civil lawsuit against Deshaun Watson. Tony Busby, he is saying that they didn't. Well, obviously he's going to say that, but hey, you know, folks are just hating on the man because he went through what he went through. There was no criminal, there was no criminal case against him. And the man is getting paid $230 million guaranteed contract. A lot of people probably hate to see that. And I would say, get over it. Okay, get over it. This is the NFL, and, you know, teams have needs, and everyone knew he's still a young guy, and he's still a good quarterback. So, hey, just get over it. He's got the money. Now, I guess they're probably going to go after some of that money in this civil suit if it even proves anything. So we should see. It doesn't really take a whole lot to win a civil suit, but we should see. But anyway, I just think, hey, you know, Deshaun Watson, I couldn't really say, you know, I didn't really make judgment on whether he did or he didn't, because, you know, I'm no expert when it comes to the law. It didn't seem right. And perhaps maybe he has dodged a bullet, but everyone deserves a second chance. Okay. I don't see why he shouldn't, why he is different from anyone else. So the fact that he's getting paid, he's going to go up there and get a second chance. Now, if you screw this up, then I don't know what to say. I probably, you know, we have an opinion for sure. But I see him as going to a team in a division that's very competitive. You got the Cincinnati Bengals that just made the Super Bowl. You got the Pittsburgh Steelers that are still doing some great things in free agency. Everyone is wanting to know who the quarterback is going to be for the Pittsburgh Steelers, but you still have the Baltimore Ravens, and the Cleveland Browns were very competitive. So Deshaun, they got their man. They got Deshaun Watson as owners of a team and spending their money. They don't really have to explain to any damn body, in my opinion. So they got their man, and that's it. Other free agency news that took place, Juju Smith-Schuster, speaking of the Steelers, he decides he wants to play football in Kansas City, did his farewell tour or message on Twitter to the Pittsburgh Steelers fans. So now Patrick Mahomes has another target there to throw the ball to. Another Pittsburgh Steelers wide receiver, James Washington, he's now with the Dallas Cowboys. So that's pretty interesting. As well as, you know, because the Cowboys did get rid of Amari Cooper, so they bring in James Washington. And speaking of the Dallas Cowboys, Randy Gregory, he's throwing a little shade out there at the Cowboys. Cowboys fans, Jerry Jones, I saw that on Twitter over the weekend, and folks are giving him a hard time on why he left the Cowboys. Now, Randy Gregory is saying, you know, that the contract was not, the language in the contract was not what it was supposed to be. Now, according to reports out of Dallas, Jerry Jones was very pissed off that the deal didn't get done, but I'm sure he had something to do with the deal not getting done. But anyway, Randy Gregory and the fans in Dallas going going at each other. Randy Gregory decides to leave the Cowboys and go to the Denver Broncos. Maybe he wanted to play with Russell Wilson. So anyway, all right. Well, folks, hey, that is going to wrap it up for this episode of the Mean Gene Show here. Like I said, once again, we're streaming live on Podbean. Wednesday, we have a now this is what be a taped show on iHeartRadio. Me and Dustin Pfeiffer will go over the Sweet 16, break it down every game, and tell you who we think is going to advance to the Elite Eight. And at this point in time, most people just tear up their bracket and start with a new bracket. They should just have a Sweet 16 bracket, give you a second chance to get it right. So that's basically what we're going to do, because we're going to have to start from scratch and go with these 16 teams and try to predict as best as we can who's going to win the national championship. So the Mean Gene Show will be in New York tomorrow and Wednesday. Please check back here on Podbean Live for the show times, because I will still try to sneak a show in there. We're going to give you one every day this week, as we have promised. And then let's see here. We're going to be at the New York Knicks game tomorrow night. That game is actually going to be on TNT. Tuesday night game on TNT, the Knicks versus the Hawks. So, hey, I'm going to try to get close to the camera and wave. Got some really good seats for this game. So we're out there promoting the Mean Gene Show in the New York area this week. So please tell your friends, other sports fans, about the Mean Gene Show. And I hope you enjoyed it today. Looking forward to the next one. And we'll see you right back here on the Mean Gene Show, streaming live right here on Podbean Live.